All right. For our final panel today, we are bringing together some of the leading entrepreneurs in the space to discuss the future of psychedelics from their perspectives. Moderating our panel is Kelsey Ramsden. She's named one of Canada's top female entrepreneurs 2 years running and is recognized globally for building multiple multi-million dollar businesses, both offline and online. She has founded and run diverse businesses ranging from construction to psychedelics and is the former president and CEO of Mind Cure Health. Please welcome Kelsey Ramsden.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for sticking around. It's great to see you all. We're going to try and have a little bit of fun here. Keep it interesting. I'm excited. This is a great panel. I'm stoked to be here in Vegas with some friends and colleagues and new friends. So I'm going to read some bios off my computer because I couldn't find a printer. So we're also, we're just kind of freestyling here. But everyone here understands that. So we'll start at the end with Sutton. Sutton King is a program manager at the Indigenous Medicine Conservation Fund, as well as the Impact Advisor Journey Collab, and the first official trustee for the philanthropic fund, the Journey Reciprocity Trust. She's also the co-founder and president of the Urban Indigenous Collective. Earlier this year, Business Insider recognized her as one of the 16 most influential women shaping psychedelics. Welcome. Next, we have Chris Claussen. Chris is the chief innovation officer of First Person, a science-driven cognitive performance company with over 20 years of experience in product and business development. He now focuses on conducting extensive research in the relationship between medicinal mushrooms and the metabolic brain and mental health. Welcome.
Thank you.
Todd Shapiro. Todd was a top-rated radio show host and successful marketing entrepreneur for over 20 years before becoming the CEO of Red Light Holland. He was an honorary chair of the Princess Margaret Road Hockey to Conquer Cancer program and is a supporter of the Center for Addiction and Mental Health and the Polar Bear Foundation. Welcome, Todd.
Thank you.
And Ronan Levy. Ronan is a pioneer in the cannabis and psychedelics industry and current chairman and CEO of Field Trip Health and Wellness, the largest provider of psychedelic-assisted therapies. He's also the co-founder of Reunion Neuroscience, host of the podcast Field Tripping, and executive producer on the upcoming documentary, Ordinary Trip. Well, welcome, Ronan.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here, guys. So at the end, we're going to have some questions, just as they have done with every other panel. So you have the QR code. You can submit as we go, so feel free to do that. And I also just want to set the stage with all we panelists, and that I think all good conversations leave some room for dissent. So if you disagree, that's great. If you agree, that's great, too. If you have a question that's tough, feel free to send it in. We're all capable and sovereign adults up here, so we can do that. So I think, I think we're here to explore this idea of what's about to happen and create a little bit of vision for the future and maybe give some insight into what we guess. I think the last 3 years can tell us that we don't always know what's going to happen with this idea of the entrepreneurial perspective and how we came to be where we are and what we might see coming in the future. So I just wanted to open with a few stats for you to give you a sense of perspective. At the moment, there are 48 publicly traded companies on the market who are predominantly and primarily involved in psychedelic medicine, whether that's research or service-based. There's about 4 ETFs, private companies. The Google would tell you there's like 43 to 100. But the pitch decks that I get, I would say it's probably more like 400 to 1,000. So there's a lot of people doing a variety of different things, legal or not. And then there's a number of funds. I think the most recent large-scale close with Palo Santo just closed about $50 million in October. So there is money still in the space. There's a lot of things happening, and we've gone through a bit of a cycle. And I think the last panel did a good job of talking about investment opportunities. I guess I'm gonna open and put this maybe to each one of you as kind of a broad question. Thinking about the future of the psychedelic industry, and you know, what do you see the future? If you close your eyes and you look 5, 7, 10 years out, know, not maybe not 20, but maybe we can start at the end with you, Sutton, and work our way back. How's that sound?
Okay. First, I'm just going to begin by introducing myself and my language. Poso, Sokoli, Sutton King, Naktau, Pinuki, Nukyatsu, Ngwehuwe, Ni'i, Wagnata, Nawagitalota, Oniota Aga, Ni'i. Hello, relatives. My English name is Sutton King, and my Menominee name is Naktau Pinuki. I'm Afro-Indigenous, and I come from the Menominee and Oneida Nations of Wisconsin. And I really open up with my language to really reclaim what has been taken from us, our culture, our way of life, our ways of being and knowing. And so when I think about what the future of this industry can look like, I think about the history that has happened to Indigenous peoples. In particular, I think about my grandfathers. My grandfathers were the last chiefs of the Menominee tribe. And Chief Oshkosh was really able to do something that inspired me. During a time where land ownership did not exist, the United States government wanted to displace the Menominee people, move us to Michigan. And he knew that for us to be able to survive, we needed to stay connected to our life source of land, our beautiful forests, one of the most dense timber forests in Wisconsin. And I think about this as he ceded 10 million acres so that we could remain on 230,000 acres today, where our ancestral story began, our creation story. And I feel this similarity between us, where he was this bridge between this time of change. And now we're moving into a place of ownership of plant medicines. And so I think about what that means, and times are changing, and this is the reality of it. And there is a collective need for healing. We are in a mental health crisis, right? And so when I close my eyes and I think about what the future can look like, I think about access. I think about benefit sharing. I think about ensuring that when we tell the story of the psychedelics and plant medicines, we do not, we're not complicit in erasure of the plight of Indigenous peoples, right? When we think about the American Indian Religious Freedom Act, and we think about settlers coming to the United States, fleeing religious persecution, only to perpetuate that upon Indigenous peoples. How can we ensure that as humanity is looking for collective healing, Indigenous peoples aren't erased, left behind, alienated? So I think about different biodiversity protocols that we can center, whether that is free, prior, and informed consent. Really, this building block woven into the United Nations Declaration on Indigenous Rights of People, also known as the UN DRIP. And a mentor of mine, Simeon, said I should share a joke. And so we always say, you know, respect the drip. And if there are some millennials in here, I'm not talking about my outfit. But on a serious note, there are these different tools that we can be utilizing, whether it is FPIC or the Nagoya Protocol, which is a biodiversity agreement signed by the Convention of Biological Diversity in 1993, 197 signing parties. Of course, the United States, who played a significant role in drafting this, is not a signer. But that does not eliminate the need for us all as entrepreneurs to think about our responsibility in benefit sharing, whether that's monetary or non-monetary, and that's all dependent on consultation and what Indigenous and traditional communities decide is fair and equitable. And so these are some of the things I think about when we look at the future, how we center these protocols, how we center these principles of kinship, of seven generation, really looking at sustainability. I'm excited because there are companies that are doing it, and I'm excited that there are conversations that are allowing these dialogues to take place. So those are some of the things I think about when I close my eyes.
I like that. It's a nice vision, you know. How about you, Chris?
Well, you know, that's Kelsey, that's a big question for
I know,
everybody
it's
in the
kick
room
it off.
Right? Like, how is this going to play out? We talk about it all the time. I'm sure everybody's thinking about it while they're prepared for this conference. And, and just throughout their businesses. So I don't know. I don't have a prediction of what that's going to be, but I can tell you where I hope it goes, right?
Perfect.
So, you know, in the conference, there's been lots of talk about the three pillars, basically, of coming up with psychedelics, where you have spirituality, you have recreation, and you have medicinal, right? But I would challenge us all to say there's another pillar that we've left out today, right? And that is proactive preventative self-care, right? Taking care of yourself first. Before things go wrong, there's a great quote from Desmond Tutu that says we gotta stop just pulling people out of the river. Mm. We gotta go upstream and see what's pushing them in, right? Yeah. And I think psychedelics could be play a big role on what's pushing them in. You know, and part of what's pushing them in my opinion, is our culture of suppression. You know, so lots of different things will happen that could lead to mental health or brain health problems in the future. But really, what causes them to bubble up and overflow to the point where you might need therapy is that you don't ever deal with them. And our society deals with them now by blunting them with SSRIs, blunting them with alcohol, blunting them with binge-watching Netflix, right? And just not dealing with the issues upstream where the stream is small. Psychedelics, as most of us probably know at this point, provide an avenue for self-realization, self-actualization, that you can actually recognize these problems before they come big and deal with them. We've kind of today, there's been dismission of microdosing a couple times, just in concentration on therapeutic doses or spiritual doses, but my own personal experience from a microdosing standpoint is that it has enabled me to become a better person by knowing myself better and being able to have better relationships with my spouse and my coworkers and people I meet. So my hope for the future is really that it ends up being with responsible adult access so that we can deal with these problems before they get big.
I love it. I do. I love it. It's a beautiful fourth pillar. I think it's like very welcomed. I think a lot of people in this room to that point, you know, believe in that. It's just how do we put that in this system? I guess that's the future. Todd, what are you thinking?
Yeah, I think a lot about this stuff, obviously, as we all do. And at the end of the day, I think it comes down to gatekeepers. Mm-hmm. And how do we eliminate, I mean, not kill, but like, how do we get rid of the gatekeepers? And I think the common theme for everyone is, you know, whether it's indigenous routes from severe trauma for, you know, multiples of years of persecution and land invasion and all this kind of stuff, to what's going on, unfortunately, with this mental health crisis today, whether you're black, white, Jewish, Catholic, I don't care.
Yeah.
There's something that's really going on right now that's affecting people all over the place. And in the psychedelic community, which is really sad, we're seeing this divisiveness as well. And I think that's sickening. I think that's gross. I think, like, I'm really angry by it, actually. Like, it really perturbs me. Why are people judging microdosing versus ketamine versus cannabis?
Yeah.
Even, like, you know, why are we're supposed to be in a community all together to help with one another. And at the end of the day, what it's coming down to for the future, you want to ask me what the future is?
Yeah.
Sadly, it's profit, okay? Mm. That's the future. If you want to know, that's where it all leads to. It leads to profit. Mm. So most people come up here, and we're a company that's publicly traded. We do. We think of profit, for sure.
Okay.
But most people are trying to limit other people's profit. And us as a company, and I think what's important is, how do you not only, of course, have profit if you're publicly traded because you want clearly to be able to help give back, but how do you get the message out there about education, responsible use, affordable and equitable access is without a doubt the most important thing. And corporations, it's our duties, all of ours, to balance the profit with the mental well-being of people, of humans all across this world. And there are we're so privileged. We're so goddamn privileged. There are third world nations that, you know, don't even have access to Medicare, don't have access to doctors, don't have prescriptions. Mm. So, you know, why are we worrying about synthesized materials versus naturally occurring materials? Why are we worried about, people who have to go to a facilitator or don't? I mean, at the end of the day, people are using magic mushrooms, people are using psychedelics. And it's almost elitist to think that because there's certain people who have used them, have had mind-blowing experiences, and have now transformed into wanting to help, but limit how they help others, why isn't everybody afforded that right to try it themselves? Mm. So again, the future, I think, is up to corporations who will raise a lot of money and get a lot of the education and research there. That's great. But work together to help humanity. Don't only focus on the profits. Mm. Focus on giving back and helping mental health.
Love it.
It's our duty.
It's tremendous. Lots of passion in that. Well, I mean, and I think part of it too, what I'm hearing you say is this idea that it's like a bit democratized and there isn't a way. There are many ways.
It's up to the people. The people should be able to decide.
Yeah.
That's simple. I mean, maybe we give licenses to people. We get a car license, we get a gun license, we get a fishing license. You know, maybe there's ways to have licenses so we understand there's an educational process that goes into that license to be able to then have some sort of, not just psychedelics, but you know, prescriptions in general, so you understand what you're getting. Mm. And I think that's the most important thing with the education of it.
Love it. Thank you, Todd. Ronan, 5, 7, 10 years?
I don't have a whole lot to add. I think most of the points that I typically raise have been hit on. I would just offer the caveat that I disagree with what you said, which is you become an entrepreneur not because you're guessing at what the future is, but because you consciously want to craft it.
Love it.
And so it's less a question of what does it look like as opposed to like what do we want it to be. Mm-hmm. That's a hard question because there's trade-off and complexity in all of those. But I think that's really the question that everyone needs to be asking, you know, especially if you're looking at it from an entrepreneurial perspective. It's like, what do I want the world to look like? What is my impact going to be? And everything I would be inclined to say from my perspective has pretty much been touched on, so I won't expand on it.
Well, I'll ask you then another question maybe that's like along the same vein is, what, you know, starting out in psychedelics, say 3-4 years ago when you started to have this orientation to doing something in space and wanting to create a thing, do you feel like you feel the same way now 3-4 years in that you want to create the same thing given the landscape and how you see it's evolving, or has that changed?
Would I create the same thing? In many respects, yes, but in some respects, differently. Not necessarily by virtue of what we're trying to achieve, but there are operational decisions being linked. Should we have done that as opposed to that, as opposed to that? But what we set out to do is change minds, right? And open the conversation and destigmatize and eliminate the taboo and kind of give people the freedom to like actually go inward and explore their consciousness and their minds and their souls and their spirits and whatever you want to call it, and just give people permission to be like, oh, I'm interested, I'd like to learn more. And I think we've done that and we'll continue to do that because we're only scratching the surface.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like that's one of the things across the industry that has remained a bit of a North Star has been this idea of creating options for people to explore themselves and other and get better. And all of the left turns and right hooks and all the kind of nuanced and infighting and things that have happened along the way is kind of a bit of a distraction. I'm grateful that it's remained this kind of good vision. I'm gonna for a second just touch back into where we've come in the last, say, 3 years to give people a sense of perspective around like entrepreneurship in the industry. So MAPS obviously has been at it for a little bit of time and really are the only phase three study out there. But hotly on the heels, of course, is Compass and then a whole slew of other folks who've gone into the drug research game. And I just looked up this morning, so we've got about 25 phase one studies on the go. We've got 3 phase one, 2, which is like a kind of a bridge study. 26 phase two studies and the one in phase three. Now, that's a lot of new research in a pretty short period of time with respect to, you know, one arena. So when you think about this idea of like entrepreneurship and some of this, you know, synthetic versus other, da da da. How much does it matter that this drug research is going on? Well, there are so many other things going on in the space. I'm just curious how, because there seems to be this like, the new measures that were just passed and the votes that were passed, and we're talking about, you know, decrim and legalization, and like there's the environment is tremendously dynamic compared to when all these people started these studies. So just like any comments or thoughts or ideas when we're thinking about this, entrepreneurial opportunities across the industries, you see things starting to evolve and change when so many people started in the research paradigm. And now that's quite a bit different.
The study I like to quote is the anecdotal one. How many people in this room have used magic mushrooms or some sort of psychedelics? By round of applause. Wait, someone wants some like merch for that? Like, that's awesome.
can I throw out this?
And so, you know, to me, that's the most important study. And we're all standing. We're all capable. We're all focused. We're all doing our best to like get by in this crazy world, I think.
Yeah.
And so listening to the people, I think, is the most important study. The future is the people. Right. So wonderful that there's a path for drug discovery, for biotech. I think that's great. Wonderful that there's a path for clinics and helping through facilitator models. That's great. And wonderful that there may be a very informed educational, not quite recreational model, but a way to distribute it to people who just want it. And another amazing path, protecting the indigenous rights, that they should be able to have that continued usage of something that's so sacred to them. Mm. So it's the path of the people. And I think once we get around all this for the future and just start accepting the realities of the situation, which are people are going to use it anyway. How many people, by round of applause, have used it illegally? And isn't that crazy to think?
Yeah.
That's an illegal, you know, I've sped, you know, I was supposed to go 50 miles an hour and I went 70. It's about as much as I break the law other than using psychedelics. And I just think that, you know, we should listen to the people, get rid of the gatekeepers, and that should be our future.
And I'd like to jump in real quick off of just what Todd shared. And I think a simple way to talk about this and to think about this is a principle that Indigenous communities have lived and centered for time immemorial, which is kinship, right? We've traditionally lived in kinship societies where leaders were looked at as facilitators and everyone's needs were accounted for. And anyone who was going to be impacted by a decision had a say in that decision. Real consultation was happening. And if anyone was going to be out of balance in this ecosystem, we brought them in to balance them, right? There was no cancel culture. There was no gatekeeping. There was no alienating folks, right? And that's our responsibility. And I think that our ability to center these principles is directly proportional to the therapeutic benefits of these plant medicines. And if we can't get that right, what can we get right?
Yeah. It's beautiful to think of it as a community aspect as well.
I'm going to go ahead and continue to challenge everybody, particularly in the industry. And that is to let's stop as a whole pretending that recreation is a bad word or a bad thing. Right?
Isn't it ludicrous?
Right. Break it down. Recreate, right? It's important. It's an important part. What are we all doing here in another hour? We're all going to cocktail hours, right? And we're all going to have, maybe not all of us, but some of us are going to have a drink or two or three or four, a known neurotoxin, the most dangerous drug that we know of.
Amen.
But yet we freely are all going to participate here and have a good time, good, honest, because having fun is important to health, right? So recreation is not a bad thing. It's an important component of being alive. But we have an opportunity to do it in a better way, maybe with, medium, mini-dose psychedelics rather than alcohol, or something that's going to be detrimental to your long-term health.
I love it.
I had a great chat last night at the dinner. Thanks to everyone at Remind. I mean, this is truly a wonderful experience.
They have done a smashing job, really.
Yeah, this is, and the dinner was fantastic. And we had this debate a little bit about, you know, recreation and stuff and recreational use. And we're all sitting there drinking too much probably last night, quite candidly.
Okay.
And I posed the question to the individuals at our table to say, if you think of, I have children, I have a 3 and a 7-year-old, and if I think of the first time they're going to go out and party with their friends, like at underage, 14, 15, as kids do.
That seems right.
What would you prefer if you could choose one, without your knowledge though, of them getting completely smashed, as unfortunately underage drinkers have, or psychedelic trips with their friends? Like, if you could choose one, what would it be? And in our case, it was magic mushrooms we were talking about. And I said, quite candidly, I would much prefer a mushroom experience than a complete getting lit off your ass experience, right? Because of the dangers we know that alcohol can create.
Truly.
And so it's just an interesting way to think about it. Of course, I'm not encouraging underage usage at all in any of it.
Asterisk.
But how we exploit and abuse alcohol is not the path forward for psychedelics recreationally. Mm. And so, you know, who has said that alcohol contributes to 300 million deaths a year? 300 million. Mm. I mean, do we really think the incidents and contraindications around recreational use of magic mushrooms will be anywhere near that number? Mm. So let's start having an honest conversation about these statistics.
That's true. And I don't know anybody who's tried to do mushrooms like every single day for 7 days in a row, but I know lots of folks.
They're not addictive. One hits your serotonin and one hits your dopamine. I mean, gambling hits your dopamine. I mean, fentanyl hits your dopamine. Like, there's a lot, like sugar hits your dopamine. So, you know, these DNA like transcription factors, like if you want to go into the science of it, I mean, we're not an addictive, those who want to use naturally occurring products, it's not an addictive quality.
One of the things I'll say, going back to the question about entrepreneurship, and it kind of touches on some of the other points that have been raised, which is, you know, if you think about what profit is, you know, it gets demonized quite a bit, the profit motive. All it means is that the inputs you put into something, someone else values it more than what you put into it, and that delta is profit, right?
Yeah.
And that creates value, and that's not a bad thing. I think what has been twisted, and so from that perspective, you know, to a lot of these points, it's like, what do people need? Again, creating that future. What do people want? You serve them that, and you have a profit opportunity, right? You create more value than you put into it. It's wonderful, and I truly think that a lot of the opportunity is facilitating access. We can all sit around and wait for the medicalization to happen, or we can just be realistic and say, like, there's opportunities to help what's happening already in a purely legal way and create positive impact and profit as well. It also leads me to the kind of second point that I was going back to, which was, you know, we think about competition as being destructive, and I think in many ways in our culture it is. But if you go actually back to the Greek notions of competition, the purpose of competition was not to beat your opponent. It was to elevate the quality of your opponent.
Yeah.
And so if we all bring that into the equation of what are we doing? We're all just trying to make each other better. And by me doing better, it forces Todd to do better. And by Todd doing better, it forces Chris, and so on and so forth. And look at it through that lens. I think we have an opportunity to create something really positively impactful that is still very much consistent with what the way our society operates right now. We can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's going to take years and years and years to kind of change how people think about community and profit. It's kind of baked into who we are right now. Doesn't mean it's right. It's just the way it is. But to shift things, it's just subtle shifts. I'm thinking about what we're doing and why, and I think that one could be really powerful. If we bring that lens into the notion of entrepreneurship, I think we could do a lot to shift some of the challenges that we face from a corporate capitalistic perspective.
I think that's a
By the way,
point.
His first-person branding, phenomenal.
Yes. Yeah.
Like, first-person, that's a really great job. You talk about competition, incredible.
Yeah. Well, this is it. And I mean, there is a bit of, and I'll just, you know, call out our industry, there is a little bit of navel-gazing in that we're in the echo chamber, we're talking to ourselves about ourselves, and it's like events like this where I wasn't here at the very first session, but I think there was like 75% of people or something said this was their first psychedelic conference, which is amazing. But there is, you know, even at Thanksgiving dinner, my sister-in-law, who's in healthcare, leaned over to me and was like, Kelsey, you might know something about this. I've heard that people are starting to use mushrooms for mental health. I was like, yeah, I do. I do know a little bit about that. And so there is still a world of people who are just coming into the notion of what's happening. And the more collaborative we can be, the more we can, like, continue to build each other up. I mean, there's a lot of people who don't yet know what can be done. And there's a lot of people already doing the work who've been doing it for an awful long time, you know? So I think, you know, we have about 6 minutes left on this. I think what I'll do is I'll just, like, let everyone state their piece and this idea of, like, for the people who are in the room who are here and curious about what are the opportunities in our space, kind of what kind of future might there be? If there's something that you could say to your past self about, you know, your entrepreneurial journey, people who might be interested in getting into the biz. I'm just curious about, or some fundamental tenets that you say, you know, if you're going to come and join us, here are some of the things, like it's working in community or that kind of thing. And then we'll throw it to some questions because I know there's a long list. My little phone is buzzing already.
You know, I'll say one, just kind of thinking about what Ronan shared. One of my mentors, Edgar Villanueva, the author of Decolonize Wealth, he always says that money can be used as medicine. And, you know, I started organizing at the age of 14 as an activist, and I was totally, you know, burned down capitalism, poverty, all of that. But really recognize that money can be used as medicine, right? And, you know, we can move away from this shareholder doctrine, shareholder primacy doctrine, and move to alternative business models like steward ownership models, where we're looking at the profits that are being made and using them in different ways, reinvesting into access or to community. I think it's the way in which we use that money. And I think it's important to really be able to center these different ways of business. I think that, you know, if you are coming to join us in the space, it's really important to consider, again, I can't stress this enough, these different international human rights standards, such as FPIC, really thinking about biodiversity. Our biodiversity today, 80% of it is stewarded by Indigenous peoples. And so when we talk about access to plant medicines or psychedelic-assisted therapy for Indigenous peoples, what we're talking about here in Indigenous rights is conservation. So if you're wanting to be an ally and you're profiting from genetic... You're profiting from genetic resources that come from traditional communities. It's important to really, you know, engage in FPIC consultation and really talk with these communities on what benefit sharing looks like. A lot of people assume that it's cutting a check. That's not true. It can be non-monetary, right? It can be community-based participatory research, setting up your manufacturing companies and signing parties, national states. It really goes a long way to just sit down and have dialogue. Outside of that, I think when we're thinking about Nagoya Protocol right now, where there's a real example happening with the Witi people in Gabon, most of the iboga and ibogaine that is accessible in the United States is illegal. You know, it's been called literally the blood diamonds of psychedelics, and so it's important to look at what's happening in Gabon with the Witi and the Ministry of Forestry and how they're working with these villages and these companies to ensure that these resources are returning back to the communities who can't even access their own medicines. So I just want to share, it's a strategic business move to implement these biodiversity protocols and these international human rights standards, and happy to talk about it with anyone who's interested.
Perfect. You guys are going to have to excuse me from the stage for one sec because I grabbed the wrong phone, which doesn't actually have the questions on it, so okay. Keep going. You've okay, got this. Yeah.
So I believe it was, you know, opportunities that I think we all know that as decrim continues to spread, and if it's in a model like Colorado where you can grow, you can possess, and you can share, that's going to blow the doors open on the gray market, where there's still going to be commerce going on, and there's probably many people here that are looking at that and deciding the risk reward for that. And there's nothing wrong with that, I don't think. But the problem with it is that we could go down a path where there's 10,000 brands out there competing for a limited amount of dollars, and in a rush to stay relevant and stay in profit, maybe you are not taking the steps the group back there is already doing. They're kind of gray marketing it through maybe a nonprofit and sharing model, and then they're doing standardization of testing, and that's important. So if all these companies, rather than waiting on legalization and waiting for rules to be put in place to say, hey, you need to have C of A's, you need to be GMP, you need to be tested, if we just do this ourselves, even as a gray market industry, and say, look, here's a blockchain certified C of A, so you know what's in this product, then you don't end up overdosing people that are maybe novice and are not ready for it, and their mindset's not right. I have some experience with people who have had that happen to them accidentally, and it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing for them. It turns them off to psychedelics and turns them off to the potential of how it could benefit them. So let's self-police it amongst ourselves and just take that extra step. If you're going to go black and gray market, why not make it as safe as possible?
It's a funny sector, right? It's a funny industry. And by funny, I mean like stressful, lose your hair, don't sleep, like have nervous breakdowns. Because you're trying to get to the consumer, which is very important in building a business, before you're getting to the regulatory process. Mm. And it's very unique and it's very rare. And personally, like representing Red Light Holland and our shareholders, et cetera, I think what we're most proud of is, you know, we work within a legal framework within the Netherlands that's sort of like our beta. You know, it's our guinea pig. Mm. And with not a huge population of about 17 million people and a place where we can grow our magic truffles, where we can brand our magic truffles, where we can sell them through a distribution company of wholesale, also have retail shops where we sell them now. We can do that and learn, and that's what I think is separating us from others, is we've really taken the approach of learning through, we have an app, an iMicro app, that consensually will track data and use, and you know, finding out what helps and what great dosage works for people, so then they can share that within the community. We have community events almost weekly. We have telecounseling support set up in case anyone has a bad experience or wants to talk through their experiences. So to be self-regulatory first, to set great corporate governance, and to be honest, we are looking at ways of giving back. Not at the risk of sounding material, we have sort of an initiative we're launching to give back for artists and artist representations of certain forward-moving charities or movements. We have lobbyists that we've helped support in Washington State. Mm. We have people in the ground in Oregon that we've helped with a program called Red Light Set Go, getting individuals there to help work who are paid, obviously. And so, you know, we are giving back as we grow. And it's we're so grateful for A, growing, for B, having the support, but C, having, you know, I'm not a pioneer in the psychedelic sector. You know, all I was someone who anecdotally used it, and it changed my life. Yeah. And for the first time ever, I thought, well, wouldn't it be neat to try to change other people's lives in a very positive way, as opposed to telling like dumb jokes, which I used to do. So they were really bad jokes, trust me. And it's been a nice pivot personally for me, and I think a really neat opportunity for the future of Red Light Holland that I think came out as a polarizing company. Mm. I mean, I'm brand first. Brands are more valuable than commodities, right? At the end of the day, you've got to be the number one brand. But if people dig deeper, peel back the layers of the onion, so to speak, I think they'll learn that you know, we really want to be very empathetic, compassionate, and just all grow together. And it's like this panel is actually, I'm getting emotional, like part of that, right? Yeah. And I've always liked working with Ronan, open discussion, and I just hope that the rest of the community thinks this way and doesn't bar journalists from coming to events because they have a different opinion. Mm.
Do I have time?
Yeah, you've got time. Yeah. Yeah.
My favorite meme on the internet right now, if you've seen it, is a video of a guy who's drawing a graph that shows the more you fuck around, the more you find out. And actually, like, I think that's like the truth to everything, which is like, don't take things too seriously. Like, be responsible, be considerate, fuck around, and importantly, listen and learn. I think that's one of the biggest challenges that I've experienced in the space so far is that there are people who are so dogmatically attached to their narrative that anything that challenges it or questions it or is different from it is completely unacceptable. And, you know, I've been in some hard conversations and lo and behold, every time you just sit down and have a discourse with them, all of that division goes away and you realize that everyone's really working towards the same thing, which is trying to better our communities and humanity and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, have your principles, but don't hold on to them too seriously and continue to learn and understand, and I think that's really important.
I will say, beautiful, by the way, but some of the academia, like the really brilliant people in this sector, man, are they come across as elitist and the hypocrisies of using and then, like, looking down on others. Like, I don't understand that, and like what Ronan just said, it's really beautiful. Like, look within and then try to look without and include. Like, you know, that's...
It's kind of the work.
Yeah,
it's doing the work on the work. It gets pretty meta. Sorry everybody, we kind of ran out of time, but you answered a number of the questions that came in the last section here. So with that, I'll just say thanks so much for being here. I'm sure everyone's open to receiving, you know, through the channels, as it were, questions if anyone feels like they had something burning that wasn't responded to. And again, thanks to the Remind folks for inviting us, and thanks y'all for coming. It's
Thank
great.
You.
Thank yeah, you. Of course.